Chapter 4 of Hints for Lovers. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Hints for Lovers by Theodore Arnold Haldane. Chapter 4 On Love.
Amore che muove il sole e l'altra stella.
Dante. The beginning, middle and end of love is a sigh. All things point to the infinite, and love more than all things else. Complex as is the character of love, here are two things which love always does. Always it refines the thoughts and heart enlarges. Milton. And love dyes all things a cerulean hue. What a pity it is not a fast colour. Love is the most antimonial of emotions. It worships, yet it will not stop at sacrilege. It will build about its object a temple of adoration, then desecrate the fane. It will give all, yet ruthlessly seize everything. It delights in pleasing, yet it sometimes wittingly wounds. Its ineffable tenderness often merges into an inclemency extraordinary. Symbol of universal duality, it is at once demonical and angelic. Nothing stands still in this world, not even love. It must grow or it withers. And perhaps that is the strongest love which surmounts the greatest number of obstacles. Love, to some, is an intoxicant, to others, an ailment, to all, it is a necessity. As is one's character, so is one's love, and perhaps the deepest love is the quietest. Love is as implacable as it is unappeasable. Nay more, love is merciless, as merciless to its votary as to its victim. For love would rather slay than surrender, would forswear rather than forego. Some loves, like some fevers, render the patient immune at all events to that particular kind of contagion. Many lovers are vaccinated in early youth. Only love can comprehend and reciprocate love. This is why, if of two sensitive human souls, the one loves passionately and the other not at all, the other is unwittingly blind and deaf to love's clamours and claims. The one may ardently urge, the other but passively yields. Only the famished understand the pangs of the hungered. Of a great and reciprocated love, there is one and only one sign, the expression of the eyes. Who that has seen it was ever deceived by its counterfeit? Did ever the same love light shine in the same eyes twice? The light of love in the eyes may take on a thousand forms, exultant jubilation, a trustful happiness, infinite appeasement or promises untold, an adoration supreme or a complex oblation, tenderness ineffable or heroic resolves, implicit faith, unquestioning confidence, abounding pity, unabashed desire. He who shall count the stars of heaven shall enumerate the radiances of love. There is no art of loving. Footnote. Ovid wrote not art of loving. Ars amandi. He wrote on the amatorial art. Ars amatoria. End footnote. Though, as Ovid says, love must be guided by art. Footnote. Art regandis amor. Ars amatoria. I4. End footnote. Yet, if love did not come by chance, it would never come at all. To each of us himself is the centre of the visible universe. But when love comes, it alters this Ptolemaic theory. Yet, it is a significant fact that love, which more than any other thing in this world, is the great bringer together of hearts, begins its mysterious work as a separator and putter at a distance. For when love first dawns in the breast of youth, it throws around objects a sacred aureole which awes at the same time that it inspires the faithful worshipper. Can only two walk abreast in the path of love? How many try to widen that straight and narrow way? Love raises everything to a higher plane, but nothing higher than the man or woman who is loved. Is there anything about which love does not shed a halo? Indeed, love is a sort of transfiguration, and when on the mount, we can very truly say, it is good for us to be here. If there is any sublunary thing equal in value to the true love of a faithful woman, it has not yet entered into the heart of man to conceive. True love makes all things lovable, except perhaps the chaperone. Was there ever man or woman yet who was not bettered by a true love? True love is ever diffident and fearful of its own venturesomeness. Footnote. Confer.
La volupte nous rend hardi, l'amour nous rend timide.
Voltaire, La Pucelle, Chan 6. End footnote. But this not every woman understands. Too often the phantasm of love and not the verity wins the day. Footnote. Celio Pari,
Storia del genere umano,
where the verities of truth and love and justice never leave the throne of Jove, but their phantasms are sent down amongst men. End footnote. Women who seek a real lover should beware the overbold one. To merge the thee and the me into one, that is ever the attempt of love. It is impossible, yet perhaps they are happiest who can longest disbelieve in the impossibility of this amatorial fusion, for it may be that such incredulity is favourable to romance. Love is not exactly a sacrifice, it is an exchange. The lover, indeed, gives his heart. He expects another in return. Love is like life. No apparatus can manufacture it, kill it, and nothing in the heavens above, or in the earth beneath, or in the waters under the earth, will resuscitate it.
How many a forlorn wight has tried to resuscitate love?
To such heights does love exalt the lover that he or she will live for days in the remembered delights of a look, a word, a gesture. But one thing is impossible to love. Love cannot create love. The intensest and most fervent love is powerless to evoke a scintillation of love. Love may worship, it may adore, it may transfigure, it may exalt the object of its devotion to the skies, but it cannot cause the object to emit one ray of love in return. Hate may be concealed, love never. The greater the imaginative altitude of love, the lower the boiling point, but love cannot always be kept at high pressure. The young think love is the winning post of life. The old know it is a turn in the course. Nevertheless, it is a fateful turn. In love, the imagination plays a very large part, and this may be variously interpreted. Thus, by man, love is regarded as a sort of sacred religion, by woman as her everyday morality. The former is the more exhilarating, but the latter is more serviceable. Indeed, love and religion are very near akin. Both inspire and both elevate. And if faith, hope, and charity are the basis of religion, there never was such a religion as love. And love is the only religion in which there have been no heretics. Why? Because women are at once its object and its priesthood. Love, art and religion are but different phases of the same emotion. Awe, reverence, worship, and sacrifice in the presence of the supreme ideal. Love knows no creed. Nay more, love acknowledges no deity but itself, and accepts no sanctions but its own. It is autonomous. And yet, love sometimes feels constrained to offer a liturgical acquiescence to the rubric of reason. In short, between the prelatical domination of reason and the recusant protestantism of love, there has ever been strife. Or, in plain language, there are two codes of ethics, one of the romantic heart, the other that of the practical head. Who shall assimilate them? The heart, in its profoundest depths, feels that something is due to reason, and reason, in its highest flights, feels that something is due to the heart. Is there a divine duplicity in the human soul? And yet, after all love seeks is love. Yet love little knows that, in seeking love, love enters on an endless search. Since love is an endless effort to realize the ideal. For love always beckons over insurmountable barriers to uninhabitable realms, promises insupportable possibilities, lures to an unimaginable goal. Yet love has a myriad counterfeits. And men and women interpret the word differently. Even different women interpret the word love differently. Thus, to one woman, love is as the rising of the sun. It shines but once in her whole life day. It floods everything with its light. It brightens the world. It dazzles her. To another woman, love is as the rising of a star. A fresh one may appear every hour of her life. And nor she, nor her world, is one whit affected by its rays. Indeed, one would hardly err if he said that many a woman really does not know whether she is in love or not. She is sought that she perceives, but which of her seekers is worthiest, which most zealous, which merely takes her fancy, and which appeals to her heart? On these matters she meditates long, to the exasperation, of course, of the individual seeker. Accordingly, men, carried away by their own passionate impulse, detest calculation of the part of women, since he stakes his all on impulse in the matter of love, says man. Why should woman stay to consider? Foolish man! He forgets that a woman always weighs a man's declaration of love, and legitimately, and naturally, perhaps legitimately because naturally. For what a woman stays to consider in the matter of love is not the potency of the impulse of the moment, but the permanent efficacy of the emotion. Therefore, it is that woman unwittingly obeys great nature's laws. Many imagine that love is a thing like a chemical element, with a fixed symbol and a rigid atomic equivalent. And so it may be. But, like the philosopher's stone, hitherto it has defied detection in its elemental form. The fact is probably that love may be compared to a substance that is never found free, and which not only combines in all sorts of relationships with all sorts of substances, but also, like many another chemical body, takes on the most varied forms not only in these relationships, but also under varying pressures and temperatures. Or perhaps it would be better to say that love may be compared to a musical note. To the unthinking, it is a simple sound. To the more experienced, it is known to consist of endless and complicated harmonical vibrations, harmonizing with some and making discord with others, notes by regular but unknown laws, differing according to the timbre of the emitter, reverberating under certain conditions, lost to the ears in others, and only responding to resonators vibrating synchronously with itself. Lastly, there is a whole gamut of love. Changing that simile, we may say that love is not like the sun, a unit and practically the same wherever seen. It is like light, all-pervading, universally diffused, and reflected and refracted and absorbed in varying degrees and varying manners by various objects. And than a great and pure love, can anyone point to anything on earth greater and more purifying? The lesser luminary perturbs the tide of human passion, the greater light draws it upward, nonetheless veritably because in tinted formless vapour. This is symbolical of love. It is the nascent thing that evokes the keenest emotions. The bud, the babe, dawn, and the first beginnings of love. So love, like sunlight, wears its most tender tints at dawn. It still remains a mystery that, out of a town full of folk, two particular hearts should worry themselves into early graves because this one cannot get that other. Yet, it is almost enough to destroy one's faith in the uniqueness of love to see from how narrow a circle of acquaintances men and women choose their spouses. Were Plato's two half-souls separated by the diameter of the globe, that were lamentable. The man often argues that esteem will grow into passion. The woman knows that the argument is utterly fallacious. Yet, unless passion is guarded by esteem, as the calyx ensheathes the corolla, the former is prone to wither. In youthful love, as in the enfolded bud, esteem and passion, like calyx and corolla, seem one and identical. It is only the full-blown flower that displays its constituent parts. Would that love could remain ever in bud. To some, love comes like a flash, to others as the burning of tinder. In all, when real love is kindled, it devours all that is combustible. But all love, like all fire, needs not only ventilation but replenishing. Unless the primal spark is nourished, it will not glow. Stifle love and it dies down. So even the love of a married pair, unless it retains something of the romance of courtship, is apt to go out. Love takes no door of surroundings. An empty compartment is as good as a coppice. Give it privacy, it is satisfied. In love, we would much rather give than take. Yet, if the giving is one-sided, there is trouble. And love brooks no half-measures. Again, trust a woman to calculate the breaking strain of her lover's heart. But she will never let him off with less than the maximum stress. When love is dead, it is perhaps best soon as buried. To determine the motions of three bodies, mutually attractive, is admittedly difficult. It is easy compared with the same problem in love. A man's work and a woman's love, though to each the sum total of life, are often things wholly and totally dissociated. Man, the egoist, thinks that if a woman loves him, by consequence she will love his work. It may be, but usually, non sequitur, for few are the women who can understand a man's work. For thousands of years, man has worked in the hunting field, in the marketplace, in the camp. For an equal length of time, woman has worked by the cradle, by the hearth. Accordingly, man has two sides to his nature, woman but one. Man wears one aspect when facing the world, he wears quite another aspect when facing women. At their work, men are rigid, frigid, austere, severe, peremptory, tyrannical, downright. With women, wherefore, O strenuous and high-aspiring man, in thy work seek not from woman's love what woman's love cannot give, but set thy face as a flint. Bethink thee of the fate of Antony, for man's chief business in the world is work. Woman's chief business in the world is love. Man's love, perhaps just because it is his plaything, not his business, is more finely tempered than his woman's, and takes on a finer edge. For this very reason, it is the more easily turned, and is the less useful. It is the pocket knife, not the lancet, that is oftener called into requisition. Also, man's love is usually a highly ephemeral affair. With a man, love is like hunger or thirst. He makes a great fuss over it. He forgets when it is appeased. Yet, when passion's trance is overpassed, it is fortunate if affection takes its place. So too, in love, it is the man who protests, and that man is fortunate who, after marriage, has not some dubious reflections as to whether he has protested overmuch. For in love, it is the man, generally, who makes a fool of himself. Love, like murder, will out, but Jill keeps her secret better than Jack. For a woman generally controls love, a man is controlled by it, and Jill's very power of making believe to be fancy-free exasperates Jack. It is a purely feminine ruse to apply a test to love, both her own and that of her lover, to prove it true. A man would as soon as think of applying a match to a powder magazine to prove it combustible. Love in woman's eyes is the supreme and ultimate arbitrator. If she is loved, love in her eyes will condone anything, anything. For to prefer honor to love is a maxim to women unknown. With them, love is honor, and therefore the maxim is meaningless and needless. It is a sort of legal, or rather charitable, fiction that women should surrender only to love. In fact, do not even the lightest of lazies and thazies make a show of being swayed by love? And no woman by too much love was ever spoiled. Man, remember that. The logic of the emotions differs from the logic of the intellect. As to the senses, alackaday, the senses never reason. Love sometimes wrecks its bark upon the rocks to prove that they harbour no mirage. Love sometimes forgets that it is possible to probe too far. Love, in pursuit of love, sometimes vivisects as unconsciously as a science in pursuit of life. Women detect the dawn of love while it is still midnight with a man. That is to say, a woman knows a man is in love with her long before he is aware of it himself. Except perhaps in this one circumstance, when she herself is in love with somebody else, and this is a highly important circumstance. Wholly to satisfy masculine infatuation is given to no woman, and perhaps wholly to satisfy feminine caprice is given to no man. So sometimes the last refuge of an unrequited love is the belief that love will create love. Nothing can be more futile than such a faith. Yet love without hope has its mitigations. But how to alleviate the pain of a love that mistook a simulated love for a true one? A simulated love is a contradiction in terms. Either one loves or one does not. That is the conclusion of the whole matter. Love would rather suffer than forget. Love would give the world to be able to exculpate a languid lover. A passionate love is perhaps always poignant. Love disdains pity. A wounded love carries a scar to the grave. In love, when honour is lost, loss of shame soon follows. Then indeed, the downward patch becomes precipitous. To some, love never comes. To some, it comes too often. But the same love never recurs, as never a bud opens twice. Happy he or she is who gains bud, blossom, and fruit. Since the sweetest love is that wherein the odorous flower of passion ripens into the nourishing fruitage of affection. But love requires careful nature, and the more exotic the love, the more difficult its culture. True and orchid may life on air, yes, but how torrid and vaporous an air. Your sturdy mistletoe thrives on the humble apple. A Cattleya requires a Colombian forest. Youth wonders at the amatory successes of middle age. Youth knows not that in matters amatory, age is no handicap. A girl in her teens will make love to a gentleman of 40, and vice versa. In fact, the indiscreet impetuosity of youth succumbs before the astuteness of age. The bachelor and the spinster both sometimes wonder that the Benedick and the bride are still their rivals, for they know not that in the amatorial art matrimony is no handicap. In short, there is no barrier at which love will balk. Nay more, love will forgive anything. Did love demand it, love, though it might blush, would not blench. And often love itself stands amazed at its own divine audacity. Indeed, love loves to immolate itself for love, knowing that to love nothing is common or unclean. For love, like charity, thinketh no evil. But remember that it is only the Uranian Aphrodite Footnote. See Plato, Symposium, etc. End footnote. That dares essay a divine audacity. Nevertheless, love is the most vulnerable of the emotions, and a love doubtful of itself would be cautiously accepted. It is not a fact that to try to feel one's own pulse is to make the heart beat irregularly. So, to try to see in a mirror the love light in one's own eyes is to bedim it. So too, if passion is not linked with affection, woe worth the day when the troth is plighted. But given passion linked with affection, ah! Nothing is criminal to love.
For love knows not conscience.
Or rather, love upsets all conventional conditions. For love creates a world of its own, a world populated by two, and these make their own laws, or make none. So a woman will imbrue her hands with blood, and a man will fling honour to the winds, and yet they twain regard each other as impeccant and impeccable, till Pippa passes. Then love always awakes to the fact that not even a community of two can live without law, and that though human laws may be outraged, those divine may not. And assuredly, the ideal love is the divine love, and in ideal love, strange but true, in a great and ardent love, when at last that is offered which was long sought, there supervenes upon the lovers a great tenderness which hesitates to make their own that for which they yearned. Almost it were as if a psychic monitor warned the conqueror to be clement and the captive to be kind. This tenderness is the worship of the soul by the soul. And of all tests of love, tenderness is the truest. But indeed, in love there are heights above heights, depths beneath depths. Who shall scale them? Who shall plumb? End of chapter 4 on love.